I know it's time you knew the village of Mortal New is all you need. The dancers are practicing, they dance to an ancient song.
Who needs a new song? This whole one glory.
This tradition is our mission, and Moana, there's so much to do. Don't trip on the terror route,
that's all you need.
Share everything we make.
We
joke and we weave our baskets. The fishermen come back from the sea.
Moana,
don't walk away. Moana, stay on the ground now. Our people will need a chief, and
there you are.
There comes a day when you're gonna look around and realize happiness is where you are. Consider the coconut.
The what?
Consider its trees.
Each part of the coconut,
that's all we need.
We make our nets from the fibers. The water is sweet and sour.
We
use the leaves to build fires.
Cook up
the meat inside.
Consider the coconut, the trunks and the leaves.
The island gives us what we need.
That's right, we stay. We're safe and we're well provided. And when we look to the future,
there you are.
You'll be okay. In time you'll learn just as I did. You must find happiness right
where you are.
I like to dance with the water, the undertow and the waves. The water is mischievous, ha! I like how it misbehaves. The village may think I'm crazy or say that I drift too far. But once you know what you like, well, there you are. You are your father's daughter. Stubbornness and pride. Mind what he says, but remember, you may hear a voice inside. And if the voice starts to whisper, to follow the farthest star, Moana, that voice inside is who you are.
Dad! I was only looking at the boats. I wasn't gonna get on them.
Come on. There's something I need to show you. I've wanted to bring you here from the moment you opened your eyes. This is a sacred place, a place of chiefs. There will come a time when you will stand on this peak and place a stone on this mountain, like I did, like my father did, and his father and every chief that has ever been. And on that day, when you add your stone, you will raise this whole island higher. You are the future of our people, Moana. And they are not out there. They are right here. It's time to be who they need you to be.
We make our nets from the fibers.
From the fibers.
We build nets from the
fibers.
We build nets from the fibers.
We sing these songs in our choirs.
We
have mouths to feed inside.
The village believes in us.
That's right.
The village believes.
The island gives us what we need.
And no one leaves.
Is called a hard sell. Moana is growing up, but she's being sold on the idea of an island. Did you pay attention to the lyrics in the song? Because they're important. The island gives us what we need. The island is about the traditions that we grew up. Who needs more songs? One song is all we need. We're supposed to be right here taking care of the people right here on our island. And I have to confess, this is the clip that sent this movie crashing into the middle of our famous first series, is because when I saw that clip, there was a passage of scripture that jumped into my head. It's Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. And I bet a lot of us know this passage very well, but I want you to listen to it. They devoted, they being the believers, the new Christians, we'll give them that name for now, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings and to the fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. And everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and they had everything in common. They sold their property and possessions to give to one another who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and they ate together with glad, sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying favor with all people. And the Lord added to the number of those who were being saved daily. And I just hear that passage, and I can see them waving the baskets and they're handing at one another, and they're sharing everything that's there. And the island is such a perfect place, and it's kind of what we've been sold, isn't it? I mean, who would want to ever leave such a place? A place where all of your needs are always met. But I have to tell you, I have a problem with this concept. I don't have a problem with the passage of Scripture, but the way that we have applied it is not what you think it's supposed to be. In the early 2000s, there were a series of books that were written, and all of the churches have bought into those books and the idea of the island philosophy. And that the purpose behind the church is to build some kind of churchtopia where everybody can come and they can sit and they can all be happy and we can sing songs and we can dance dances and we can share everything. And that's the picture that we've painted for the church. Unfortunately, that's the picture we've painted for the purpose of the church. And so I have an interesting question I'd like to ask you and really wrap your brain around this idea for just a moment. If that's the picture we're supposed to build, and the church achieved that picture in Acts chapter 2, why do we need the rest of the book? Hear the question again. If the church achieved its mission in Acts chapter 2, and the churchtopia was built, and the island was there, and everybody was happy, and everybody was singing, and all the believers had commonality, if that was the purpose behind the church, why do we need all the rest of the book of Acts? Don't you think that's a fascinating question? Could it be that we have the wrong idea about what we looked at? We're not looking at the purpose of the church. We're looking at the beginning of the mission of the church. Because let me tell you something. There's a lot more verse that go beside that famous verse on the island. And just so you know, that's not where our passage of Scripture is today. So don't settle into Acts chapter 2 just yet. We'll be back in just a moment. But I want to talk about where we're at. We are in our third week of this famous verse series. We are walking through the book of Acts. This is not a verse by verse or a chapter by chapter study. Eventually we'll start moving a lot quicker. We are looking for those moments in time where the church had a first time experience. And what we want to find out from those first-time experiences is what changed and how do I apply that today in 2017 for our church, because we don't live in first century Jerusalem. Our culture is different from those, and I know that we cannot apply it just like we saw it there. So today, as we continue this mission, we're not going to spend a lot of time looking at the very first picture of the church, because I think we got it. We all understand what it is we're supposed to, what we think we're supposed to be doing at church. But I'm not interested in what we think we're supposed to be doing. I'm interested in finding out what is the mission of the church. And for that, you have to turn the page one more time, and you end up in Acts chapter 3. And we're going to look at the very first recorded miracle. Now, I have chosen my words very carefully, because this is not the first miracle that we see in the church. As a matter of fact, in that passage that we just read, Acts chapter 2, verse 43, it says, everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and signs were performed by the apostles. So obviously, on that island, there were wonderful and beautiful things happening, and maybe healings, and maybe they were doing other miracles and other ministry things. There was something good going on the island. So this is not the very first miracle that was ever performed. But can you please tell me what the miracles on the island were? No. There's no detail given. It just said, these are the things that happened. So it wasn't actually recorded. It was just kind of like mentioned in the byline. I am much more interested in the first recorded miracle that actually happens in Acts chapter 3. And we're going to be in verses 1 through 7. And this is what it says. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer at 3 in the afternoon. Now, a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have I give to you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Walk." Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. Now, we're familiar with this passage. If you went to VBS when you were a kid at any point, I'm guaranteeing you this is probably one of the most used VBS lessons that are out there. Everybody seems to love this story. But I'm fascinated. Why this one? I mean, why not another miracle? I mean, what makes this miracle so special that it becomes the very first recorded miracle in church history? Why is it special? Well, just so you know, it's not a special day. As a matter of fact, the passage doesn't even tell him what day of the week it was. We don't know if it was Sunday or Monday or Tuesday or Wednesday or Thursday or Friday. Or it just says one day. It doesn't tell us where we're talking about, the fall or the winter or the summer. It doesn't tell us anything about anything as far as the day goes. It just says it was a day of the week. Nothing special. So if it's not the day of the week that's special, maybe it's the place that was special. Well, it wasn't really a special place. I mean, okay, they were at the temple. And so I guess I don't want to pay any disrespect to the temple. It was a special place in the Jewish tradition, but in reality, they went to that temple every single day. Every day of their life, we kind of get this idea that the Jews only went there on the Sabbath. They went to that temple every single day. As a matter of fact, where it was stationed, to get from one side of the city to the other, you could go through the temple court, so it was kind of a shortcut. Instead of going around the hill, you'd go up and over and straight through. So they always went to this temple. This was not an unusual place for them to be. It was just there. Nothing special. So if it's not the day, and it's not the place, maybe it's the time that's special. Not really. The Bible says it's 3 p.m. I mean, at least it does tell us it's in the afternoon. I'm happy to know they weren't doing this at the crack of dawn, so it doesn't require us to get up early. But it does say it's 3 p.m. in the afternoon. Now, I want to jump on something right here, because I mentioned this last week, and I told you I was going to keep pointing this out. They were Christians. They were followers of Christ. But the reason they were at the temple that day was because it was the Jewish tradition, the time of prayer. So although they were following Christ, as I told you last week, they were beginning to hitch their Jewish traditions to their new Christian faith, and they were still practicing Judaism while following Christ. It's important you keep that in mind, because at some point, that has to get over. That's another sermon for another week. But this particular time, they were going there at 3 p.m., and just so you know, they did this every day. Every day, this was like a village-wide, a Jerusalem-wide thing, where if you were a devout Jew, you went to the temple at 3 p.m. to pray. This wasn't an unusual event for them. It's 3 o'clock, time to be at the temple. It's kind of like on Sunday morning, 10:30 in the morning, where am I supposed to be? Here? It's not that it's necessarily a special part of my schedule, it's just it is what I did. So, if it's not the day, and it's not the place, and it's not the time, maybe it's the man that was special. Quick question, what's his name? You have absolutely no idea. You know why? It doesn't tell us. As a matter of fact, this man was just a beggar. This man was a guy that sat at that temple gate every day of his life. It says he was carried there and he was left there by his friends simply because he wanted to come there not to do a spiritual thing. He was there to get paid. Okay? He came there to basically collect money so that he could go out and have the money that he needed to sustain his life. There was absolutely, positively nothing special about this man. He just happened to be in the right place at the right time on the right day of the week when God decided to do something special. And so maybe it wasn't necessarily the man. Maybe he made a special request. But when I read the scripture, his request wasn't all that special. All he wanted was some money. Do you know what? And James, Peter, and John had just reached into their pocket and pulled out a few little bronze coins and made them tinkle in his cup. That man would have went about his day happy. Because you know what? That's what he was looking for. He wasn't requesting that he be healed. He wasn't requesting that his life be changed. He wasn't requesting anything special. He just was doing what he always does. And so I'm left. If it's not the day, and it's not the place, and it's not the time, and it's not the man, and it's not the request, what makes this special? And I think it's because of the very special response from Peter and John. Now, I want you to put this back in context. Remember, on the island, miracles and signs and wonders were being prepared. Where they were going and they were worshiping on a regular basis, all of those things were going on. But those were all happening amongst believers. They were all happening amongst people that had already confessed Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. They were all happening amongst the church itself. This one's a little different. Because this man had probably never been to church his entire life. He was just a man sitting by the gate trying to make a living. And when he asked Peter and John for a little bit of money, their response, well, it began the idea with they looked. Now, remember I told you, the man came to the gate every single day. And the 3 p.m. time of prayer happened every single day. So that means you can go ahead and do the math in your mind. That means Peter and John would have walked past that man numerous times. He had probably asked them for money many times. As a matter of fact, he might have been one of those guys that when you see him laying there, you know he's going to ask for money, so you make it a point to try to be walking on the other side or have a buffer between you and him so that you can walk past him and not feel guilty at all that you didn't put anything in the cup. They had seen this man a bunch of times in their life. But for the first time in their life, they looked at him. For the first time in their life, they noticed this man. And when they noticed him, they spoke to him. Now, this ties beautifully into our sermon from last week. Because if you remember, when the Holy Spirit came on the church, what did the church begin to do? They began to speak. And so as Peter and John were headed into the temple this day, and they saw the man lying there as he had always been lying, and they looked at the man, and the first thing they decided to do is they spoke to him. I wonder how many people spoke to this man that day. How many people probably fulfilled his request and dropped a few coins into his cup and scurried off into the temple so they wouldn't be late for their time of prayer? You see, Peter and John, they were doing something unusual when they began to speak to this man. And then when they spoke to him, they said, "Look at us." They got this man's attention. You see, they were trying to turn his attention off of the cup. They were trying to turn the man's attention off of the money. Trying to turn the man's attention off of his physical needs, because they had something bigger to to give him. And then after they got his attention, they offered. Now, they didn't pull out their wallets. They didn't pull out their checkbook. They didn't give the man a lecture on physical responsibility. And isn't there a better way you could do this? They didn't give the man a lecture about, you know, these people are going to church. You shouldn't be doing this. They didn't do any of that. What they did is they offered him the only thing they had on him at that point. Jesus. They just made him a simple offer. And then after they offered him, they did the unthinkable. They touched him. Now, you have to understand that we're in Rome. Well, not in Rome, we're in Jerusalem, but we're in Roman times. And their streets aren't paved like ours. And they don't drive cars that are environmentally conscious. They ride horses. And while we have exhaust, so do horses. And the exhaust from horses have to go somewhere, and that was usually on the side of the road. So if this is where this man laid, he was not a nice-smelling man. As a matter of fact, he was probably dirty. I mean, and they touched him. They extended their hand to his hand. They didn't just tell him to get up. They helped him up by offering him a hand. And that is an incredibly special reaction to this request. I mean, it would have been easier, wouldn't it? Just to pull out a few coins and put it in the cup and scurry along your way. It would have been easier if they had just yelled the miracle back to the man, but they got personally involved in this man's life, even to the point that they reached out their hand and touched him. And I want to tell you something. The moment they did that, something in the church changed. Acts chapter 3, verses 8 through 12. He being the man, jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Peter speaks to the onlookers while the man held on to Peter and John. All the people were astonished and came running to them in the place called Solomon's Colonnade where Peter saw. When Peter saw this, he said to them, "Fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power and godliness we have made this man to walk?" Things, they were changing. And I want to go with the Captain Obvious thing that happened. The man was indeed healed. A man that was simply looking for a few coins to go buy bread found something that was so valuable that it changed his life forever. Something else changed for that man. The man went into the temple. Every day of his life, friends had taken him and carried him to the temple gates, and they left him sitting right there at the gate, but he never went inside. He never got to experience God firsthand. All he could ever do is hear the hustling and bustling of the people going to and fro, but no more. Now he can get up on his feet. And it said, where was the first place he went? Straight into the temple, and he was praising God. Because guess what? Change was happening. You see, this is quite different. This man is now a different person, but not so different that the people didn't look at him and say, "I know you from somewhere, don't I? No, don't tell me. I'm good with faces. I recognize you." Wait a minute. Was it all a scam and you were just laying on the side of the road all these years just to get some money out of me? No, they knew better than that. Because nobody picked that occupation because they wanted it. They did realize, oh my goodness, this is the man that was laying by the gates. We haven't seen this kind of stuff since that crazy prophet from Nazareth was executed. What on earth is going on here? You understand, this man was making a difference because the change began to impact the people. The people began to look at him, and they were in wonder, and they were amazement, and they were murmuring to one another, and they were asking questions. How can this be? What happened? What's changing? What's going on? Don't you know what's going on? Who did this? Who's responsible? And the whole buzz is going on, and what began to happen is the focus began to change. Do you remember why they were there in the first place? It was 3 p.m. in the afternoon. It was time to pray. It was time for the temple courts to become quiet as people began to kneel and they began to pay homage to God. And now the apostles have caused this great big ruckus because in this reverent time, in this reverent place, there's now praising and singing and dancing and commotion. And the focus began to change because they were no longer focused on their religion. They began to focus on what's going on. My life is changing right before my eyes. And you know what the biggest change was out of all of this? The church grew. If you turn your page over to Acts chapter 4, verse 4, the result from all of this is, as we began to look at this, and Peter began to preach to them and telling them how this could be. By the way, if you read Acts chapter 3, verses 12 through 26, you're going to see the same outline that Peter gave us last week. When Peter got their attention, he told them God's story, Jesus' story, and his story. And as they heard, that began the story. The church began to grow because it says, but many. Now, I do want to point out, it does not say all. It does not say everybody. It says many, so that means we're above 51% of the people that were listening. So I don't know how many did not listen. But this is important to us because not everybody that saw this great miracle accepted Christ. So you can guarantee them that everybody that hears our message will accept Christ. Our job is not to make Christians. Our job is to speak Christ. Many who heard the message believed. And so the number of men who believed grew to about 5,000. Now you do the math. Last week we had 3,000. Now we have 5,000 total, so some basic arithmetic here. So we're talking 2,000 more people that we spent the day leading to Christ because of this miracle. And do you know what this is? It's the first evangelical meeting that you ever saw in the Bible. It's the first moment when God took it off of the island and took it right into the face of humanity. There is something different going on. This is not what you expected at this moment, because things, they're changing. And the apostles, they were indeed, as Jesus promised, starting in Jerusalem, and they were definitely impacting Jerusalem. But I want to go ahead and add a little warning label here. It was not their goal. It was their beginning. When we look back at Acts chapter 2, the island was not the goal. It was just where Jesus said, you're going to start. What was the promise? He said, you're going to start in Jerusalem. As a matter of fact, you stay in Jerusalem until you got the Holy Spirit with you. So you're going to start in Jerusalem. But as we go, the island was never the point. It was always about the horizon. It's that moment when Moana is standing up on that mountaintop and her dad is showing her those wonderful stones of tradition where all the chiefs had piled their stones upon the island. And as soon as you lay your stone, Moana, then guess what? This island will be higher by one stone. And then what does he say? Hey, Moana, look down. You see the people on the island? Those are your people. Stop looking at the horizon. And when we finished listening to her song, she looked like she got it. Don't count on it. If you've seen the movie, you know we have a long ways to go. But what I want to move on to is this miracle. How does it apply to us? Because I read the events, and I just want to tell you, I don't have the gift of healing. Okay, I can't look at somebody and say, silver and gold have I none. Get up and walk. I don't have that gift. I would like to. I know where my ministry would be. I would spend my days at Augusta Medical Center, walking up and down the halls. But I don't have that gift. So since I don't have that gift, how do I apply this to me? Well, remember, there are two definite ways that we can apply this to us. The first thing is, you don't have to wait for the special. We are a people that are built on special occasions. Man, you give somebody a reason to invite, and they will invite. It's like we think it has to be Easter or Christmas before we can invite anybody to church. Maybe Mother's Day. Maybe this, maybe that. Maybe we're having a special Sunday and it's a high attendance. Maybe we have that. But we think we have to have some kind of special reason to go out and talk to people about Christ. That's not the case. You don't have to have a special moment. As a matter of fact, if the Holy Spirit is living within you, it just says it's just going to come out on a regular basis because he is here to testify to who Christ is. You don't need a special moment. You know what else you don't need? You don't have to have a special place. You don't have to wait until you have somebody standing in front of a cross, just standing there. You don't have to wait until you're in some kind of religious place. You don't need a special place to share Christ. You could do it on the street corner. You could do it in the restaurant. You could do it, I wouldn't suggest sitting in traffic. That could be a little dangerous. But you could do it in the park. You could go wherever you want. And there is no longer a special place to share Christ. The gospel is not designed for a special people. You don't have to know a secret handshake or say some secret code or do some secret sacred ritual just to have a relationship. It isn't just for special people. The gospel was designed for everybody, even the ones on the side of the road that we never in our life would imagine that we would stop and talk to. It was intended for all. And the only way it gets out there is that is our mission, not the island. If you find yourself stuck on the island, understand you're here, but this is not where God intended us to be. So what's the other application that I can make out of this for us? Share what you have. Now, these were the words that Peter says. He says, then Peter said, silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. Now, I find it interesting. Peter made sure he said, I don't have any silver or gold. He didn't say anything about bronze. Okay? I got a sneaking suspicion that there probably maybe was a change stuck in the bottom of his pocket. Because he was headed into the church and he was headed into the temple. And you don't go to the temple without taking a donation. That just did not happen in Jewish tradition. If you went in there, when you turned in, guess what was right there? The treasury, the place that you're supposed to make your... So I got a little sneaking suspicion that he probably had a little change in the bottom of that pocket somewhere. If not, maybe he could have at least taken the man out to a nice meal, right? I mean, there were other things that he could have done. But Peter offered him what was offered to him. He said, silver and gold, that's not what you need. Because if I give you silver and gold, you're going to spend that. And then you're going to be right back in this same situation in just a few days. Because silver and gold is not the answer to your problem. You know what the answer to your problem is, sir? His name is Jesus. And that's what he gave him. Silver and gold have I none, because that doesn't solve the issue. What I do have... Jesus. And let me show you how he can solve your problems. See, I think a lot of times the church, the world has stopped listening to our message. It's because they don't think we believe it. They don't think that God solves our problems, so why should I think he's going to solve my problems? Because we never tell people just what God is doing in their life. We fail to be the witness. We don't share our part of the story. So, Peter did not give the man what the man wanted. Because we all know what he wanted. And by the way, this is not a lesson that we should never give money or do things. No, absolutely not. We're going to see that in a week or so that they had next week. We're going to see that giving money and helping people was a big part of the early church. But in this particular occasion, at the very first miracle, Peter didn't give the man what he wanted. Peter did not give the man what Peter wished. Peter only gave the man what he had. Peter offered him Jesus. So this morning, as we're thinking about this, and I know we all like the island. I like the island. I like to come here, and I like to see faces and friends and people that I know. I don't know that I like singing the songs because I can't sing. But I do enjoy it when I hear other people singing, and I do my very best. I enjoy that. I enjoy the island life. But here's the thing. There's something more to this. How do I know? Because there's about 20 chapters left in the book that we haven't read yet. How do I know? Because Jesus never said, build an island in Jerusalem, and therefore you shall say, and I will send the world to you, just like I did in the Old Testament. That's an Old Testament model, the island. The New Testament model looks much different. The New Testament model is build them up and send them out. Build them up and let them go. Build them up so they can go out and share it with the world. Build them up because the island is our home, but our mission is the horizon. You see the difference? It's a big deal. Because if you grasp this idea, we can come here and we can even have crazy days where we wear Hawaiian lays and we put on our Hawaiian t-shirts, and you never know how strange I've been challenged. Can I actually weird everybody out? I got a couple more levels I can go here, folks. So yeah, people are like, no, don't do that. Please don't do that. But I do want you to see. We can have, the island can be the place that we build ourselves up and we feed ourselves. But understand, we're not here to live. We're here to basically gas and go. Put the fuel in and go out to the world. So this morning, I want to ask you, is the island your home, is the first question. And then that question, this is what I mean. Have you come to the point that you have established a personal relationship with who Jesus is? Have you met the man that Peter offered to the man at the gate? And as we sing our time of decision or our time of whatever you want to call it, invitation, if you have not done that, but you're curious about who this man is that can change lives, this time of decision is for you to come forward, and we'll talk about what it means to be a Christian. That's making the island the home. Now, if you've already done that and you've already established your residency, and I don't mean necessarily you've joined this church, I mean you're just, you know, you have a relationship with Christ. If you've done that part, let me ask the other question. Where's your focus? Is your focus still on the island? Or is your focus on the horizon out there? Because I know where the mission is. I absolutely, positively know who the church was meant to be.